here. Genesis, the 15th chapter, looks like. Quick review, it's very important that we do a quick review last week, because last week there were some promises to Abraham. That was in Genesis, the 12th chapter, verses 1 through 3. I think the promise is spelled out, or not completely spelled out, but that's where the covenant is beginning, I do believe, Genesis 12. Yeah, the Lord told Abraham in verse 2 of Genesis 12 chapter, I'll be a great nation. I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And verse 3, and I will bless them that bless thee, and curse them that curse thee. And in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. So God promised Abraham that he was going to bless him. I'm going to make you a great nation. I'm going to make your name great, and you're going to be a blessing. So that was the promise of Abraham last week. This week, we're going to look at the promise along with prophetic utterance that God gave to Abraham through his visitation. How did God visit Abraham? How did God speak with Abraham? We're going to see today in visions. So, I think a grounding verse will help us out. I think it's going to be in 2 Peter, talking about a more sure word. 2 Peter 1:19. 2 Peter 1:19. A prophecy is a future event. It's going to happen in the future. Abraham, when God gave this vision to Abraham, like I mentioned last week, all of it was not fulfilled in Abraham's day. I'm going to make your name great. I'm going to make you a great nation, and you should be a blessing. And then we're going to see today that God promised Abraham a lot of seed. And was all that, all those promises fulfilled in Abraham's day? No, but so God gave him a prophetic utterance. And that's what we find in 2 Peter 1:19, where the Apostle Peter referred back to God's promises and words spoken by God. We have also a more what?
Sure word.
A sure word. That's what it says in 2 Peter 1:19. We have a more sure word of prophecy, of utterance. That's what it's a prophetic utterance. Whereunto you do well if you take heed, if you listen to it, as unto a light that shineth in dark in a dark place until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts. So prophetic utterances from the word, from God. Peter says that we have a more sure word. And so Peter is talking about the Messiah, but he's all other utterances and things referencing to the Messiah. Peter says, we, the 12, we that was with him, we that saw and handled him, was with him, we have a more sure word. We have a more complete word of prophecy. So, we have the promises given to Abraham back in our lesson today, Genesis 15 and 1. And we also understand that just for historical purposes and just to kind of get a glimpse of what was going on, God made that promise to Abraham when Abraham was how many years old?
75
years old, God made that promise to Abraham. 75. Yeah, okay, now. Can we get too old to receive the promises of God? Can we get too old to see the word of God fulfilled in our lives?
No.
Can we be too old to see the promises? No, 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 no. And Peter is saying, no, we have a more sure word, and the promises of God are for you as soon as you believe. As soon as you believe, the promise goes into effect. And the promise is not just for you, but it's for your seed after you. Look at this land, Abraham. Wow, that's a lot of land for one man, but it's enough for a nation. Okay, so the promise is not for you, it's for you and everybody that's coming along behind you. Okay, so our lesson today says, here's the things we're going to be with concerning with today. Is that Abraham was fatherless. He was fatherless. When God makes a promise to us all, we all have our things that concerns us. God, we got God's word here. He gave it to us. But there's some things that concern you. Okay, God, when's my address going to change? What about me? I haven't got what I've been looking for, expecting, want to have in my life. What about it's finding your promises landing on my doorstep? That's a good promise you've made, all that. Great nation, going to be a blessing, and all like that. Abraham says, I got a more immediate concern. So what was Abraham's more immediate concern?
He needed an heir.
He didn't have a child. He didn't have a child. I mean, we have, look, got this one guy in my house. He could be the heir. But I really don't want him to be the heir. So I have a more, I got something concerning me. That's how we have to take God's word. Is that, okay, God, that's great. All the promises. But I got an address, and you need to come, not Santa Claus, but you need to come. That promise need to hit my doorstep, because I got a personal concern. Abraham's was that I go fatherless. And guess what? I'm 75 years old. Yeah, childless. And guess what? I'm 75 what?
Years
old. So. All right. So we got to get down to business here. We ain't got a lot of time. That was okay. So first of all, what Abraham need to understand is that God is he's able and willing to fulfill his promise. That's what Abraham had to. He bought into that fact. God's able and willing to fulfill that promise. All right, now, here we go in our first scripture. After these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abram in a, how did he get to him? In a vision. In a vision. Say, anybody ever had a vision? Okay. Fear not. Fear not, Abram. Now, everybody make note that we're calling this guy, his name is Abram, not Abraham. It's Abram. Fear not, Abram. I am thy shield and thy exceeding. What kind of reward?
Great
reward. I am thy shield. In other words, shield is broke, is defined as I am your divine protection. I am your divine protection. And I am your surety of what I have said. I'm the backup of everything that you heard. I'm your divine protection, and I'm backing up everything that you have heard. All right, now. And Abraham says, you know, all these great promises. How many hear the preacher preach? Cut potatoes on Sunday? And all
that.
Mashed potatoes. Good message. Good message. Doing the funky chicken and everything. Well. Then he says, but I got a deal. I need you to deal with God in my life. My address. And my address, Abraham says, that I go childless. I go childless. Okay, and that's what he said in verse 2. Abraham said, Lord God, what will thou do what? Give me. So there's no ifs and buts about it. There are some things in everybody's life that God's got to, when you want God to come across for you. You want your own trophy. You want your own achievement. You want your own, this is God, this is mine, this is what God has done for me. That's otherwise, the scripture in Mark 11, 23, 24 is no good. Because whatsoever things that who desires? Somebody else? Neighbor across the street? No, what you desire. Whatever thing, things, fame, whatever that you want. So that's what God is trying to satisfy and prove to you about his word. He's trying to get to you. God's answer. Abraham said, Lord God, what would thou give me, seeing I go childless, and the steward of my house is this Eleazar of who?
Damascus.
He's not really my kin. He's not of me. He's just a steward, servant, good one. But I don't want to leave all the things I have accomplished to him. I don't want to do that. All right. So, just for the sake of everybody know what the lesson, how it goes by Abraham's life. How old do you think Abraham was when Ishmael was born?
75, 86.
86. all we got. 11 years later, Abraham gets tired of waiting on God. 86 years old, I'm taking stuff into my own hand. I'm going to help you out, God.
Well, he didn't actually say that he was his wife that brought the idea to him.
Okay.
Yeah. She told him that it was bad day, and she would do this and that way. By the law, that it would be there.
Legally.
Yeah.
Legally, it could be. Yeah, why are you waiting on something? Sometimes it's kind of like coming around to Job's wife, telling him that, you know, you ought to just curse God.
Curse God, man.
Let me get this. There's something that you can do. What is it that you're not doing to fulfill, get this promise to be fulfilled in your life? And that's a trick of the devil. But he's trying to get you to make a step, make a move to help God out. And we're going to see today that when God makes a promise, it's a way that he tells you and shows you in that vision, that confirmation, that he's not going to need anybody, any help from anybody else. And it's pretty much telling you when he brings that promise to you or to fulfill that one thing that you really want in your life, he pretty much tells you initially, stay out of the way. Pretty much gives you, stay out of the way. And nothing you can do to bring this about. But I'm going to promise you that I'm going to fulfill it in your life. Ain't nothing you can do to make it happen. You are nobody else. You're going to give me that kind of promise. So God will give you that kind of ain't nothing, nobody. I'm the only one that's going to get the Lord has said he's the only one that's going to get the glory for bringing this to pass. And a lot of times it's so what? Awesome. That we know immediately, there ain't no way that I can do nothing about it. No way. I just going to believe God's word and act like I believe it. Because I don't know how. And Sarah did like a sister just did laugh. Yeah, okay. She just laughed. Ain't no way I can do nothing about it, so I might as well believe it. You know, it's a good thing, so believe it. You know. Okay. So Abraham, verse 3. Abraham said, he said, look, God. To me thou hast given what?
No seed.
And look, one born in my house is what? Mine heir. Kind of like trying to blame this on God. The situation I'm in right now, it's your fault, because you ain't cutting corners on that. And this is what we got today. So yeah, somebody knows something needed to happen. So when God is dealing with you directly, when you're dealing directly with God in your prayer closet, you can talk like Abraham is talking. Look, man, look, God. This is where I live. And this is what I'm here right now. I got all these promises of yours, but I just want to make sure you know my address. That's what Abraham, this is where I'm living at right now. One born in my house is my heir. Verse 4. All right. Verse 4. And behold, the word of the Lord. How did it happen? The word of the Lord did what?
Came
to him, saying, this shall not be thine what?
Heir.
But he that shall come forth out of thine what?
Own mouth
shall be thine heir. Now, how did the word of the Lord get to Abraham? How did that word get embedded in him to where he could hear it to say, that guy in your house is not going to be the recipient of your will, but one born out of your own gut is going to be your heir? Anybody got any ideas?
How did it get to it?
How did it get to it?
Because the Lord came to him.
The Lord came to him.
Spoke to him in a vision.
Yeah, he spoke to
him. He may have, in a vision.
Yeah, he may have closed his eyes so that he couldn't see him, but he definitely knew that he was there.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, how can you not feel his presence when he's talking
directly
to you?
Okay. Anybody ever had a vision of something from the Lord? I mean, you know that whatever's going on, this is the Lord. Yeah. And I haven't been in nothing like this before, and stuff is happening, and gonna be over, you know, it's just as real as it is, but 20, 30 minutes, you're looking around, whatever. Oh, really? Just like that. Yeah, sometimes, you know, he has to get your attention, so you, hey, get out of the way. Ain't nothing you can do. I got it. You ever been like that with some of your friends and relatives, trying to build a house, dog house, something, wash the dishes, get cooking in the kitchen? Get out of the way. I'm helping you, I'm going to do this. Best way you can help me is go over there out of town somewhere. Wait for me to call you. So there's nothing you can do. So sometimes God has to get our attention that way through a vision. Through a word, through a prophecy, through another saint. Okay, you need to slow down. Someone will tell you straight up, face to face. You in the way. You said that wrong? Okay, I thought you were saying something. All right, so the word came to him, verse 5. And he brought him forth abroad. Who did? The Lord did in this vision. He brought him forth abroad and said, look now toward heaven. Tell the stars, if thou be able to number them. And he said unto him, so shall thy seed be. Wow. Now I want to take us to Genesis 22 and 17. Okay. This is Abraham, I guess, trying to do stuff on his own. It says in verse 16, and if a man entice a maid that is not dethroned and lie with her, Exodus. What did I get? Okay, how do I get there? Okay, yeah. Someone read, please.
22:17.
Yeah.
That in blessing I will bless thee. Yeah. And in multiplying I will multiply thy seed. Yes. As the stars of the heaven and as the sand which is upon the seashore.
Yeah.
And thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemies.
Yeah, okay, so that's in conjunction with what we just read, and so shall your seed be. We can look into the sky at nighttime, particularly the last couple two or three days. Everybody seen the full moon? And probably seen some stars. Anybody seen any stars? Guess how many more? You think that's all up there?
Matter of fact,
there's a million stars out there that we can't see with the naked eye.
Yeah.
And it's just, wow, awesome. So it says, and if you pay the count, you can have more. You got the number. Overwhelming promise again. Genesis, maybe 13:16. And I will make thy seed as the dust of the earth, so that if a man can number the dust of the earth, then shall thy seed also be numbered. That's just, you know, God, why would you tell me something like that? You want me to get my belief system into that? I got to wrap my head around it. You can't get your head around it. You can't get your mind around it. Wow. So, faith is not the mind. It's got something to do with the mind, but the mind ain't got nothing to do. The comprehension you can't comprehend the depth of God's promises, the structure of it, the construction. So if you start trying to understand God's promises by how he can actually do it, construct it, how is this? You'll never get there. Because our mind is just limited. And God did that on purpose. I think it might have been in the 10th chapter of Genesis, you can see that God purposely made sure that man had in his own right limitations. And that was when they were building that tower. chapter 11, verse 1. Yeah, and the whole earth was one language, one speech. And this is how, if you leave man to back to his intellect, this is what you get. We're going to build us a tower. We'll get to heaven. If you leave it to man's intellect, this is what he's coming up with. So verse 7 of chapter 11, let us go down and there confound their language that they might not understand one another's speech. So God says, I'm going to mess man up, because he think he, and if you don't,
you can do it.
And if you don't, man, I ain't no telling what he'll come up with. Because he has that capacity to really mess stuff up. But he has the capacity to believe into greatness. And he also has the capacity to really mess some stuff up. So God says, we're going to take it out of man's hand. And that's the last time he dealt with what man could come up with without him. So man hadn't thought about it all this. He's flying to the moon, ready to go to Mars now and everything else. He got to figure out all that stuff out there. And God had already said, I gave you Earth. I'm trying to go everywhere else. Moon, Mars, whatever else we plan, we got enough gas to get there. We're going to try and make it. So that's me. So now God is saying, now, so shall your seed be. This is how awesome I am. Now, there's only one way, no matter what God promised you, for you to get it fulfilled in your life. And you might as well buy this loaf of bread and get ready to sell you right along. Only one way. You got to believe. You got to choose believe. And you got to get your mind built up. You got to get your vocabulary built up. It's changed, converted over to whatever it is that you got to do to get into developing that belief system. 75 years old, Sarah laughed. So we wait some years later, we gotta do something. You're 86, Abraham, ain't nothing happening yet. Yeah, go away, we're 85, and you better go talk to the girl over there. So you got all kind of temptations along the way. You get these things fulfilled, but the only way you're going to really get them in your life, to have them, to handle them, tangible, is to believe. You just got to believe. Come what may, this is where you'll find me, standing in the line of belief, looking for the promise. Talking like I got the promise. So now we're going to figure out, once you get there, why do you receive the promise? Because if you deal with man, it's going to give you a number of reasons as to why you did or you didn't receive the promise. If you leave it to man. But if you leave it to God, he has one qualification. The word is righteousness. And how do I obtain righteousness to where everything God has said I will experience? How do I get there? It's going to be all kind of languages and sounds in the world to get you into righteousness. But there's only one way to get there. Faith. Believe. Okay, so let's see. Verse 6 says it. Someone read it boldly if you would. 15:6.
And he believed in the Lord, and he counted it to him for righteousness.
And he believed in the Lord. Now, some people just stop right there. I believe. How many in here believe? I believe in the Lord. But now, and God did something. The word counted is a word you need to study in every age that it was ever spoken. Counted. C-O-U-N-T-E-D. Counted. How many are going to get your taxes done this year? You're going to take a tune in. You're going to do advance. I count. He's going to give some counting. He's going to count. This guy is sitting down balancing it out. This is what they owe. This is what you owe. Based on the numbers. And everybody say, numbers don't what? Lie. One and one is two every day.
Yeah.
Two and two is four, no matter how sophisticated you get. Numbers don't lie. So the guy doing the counting is the surety. He's the man in the middle, your accountant. He's the referee. He's doing the counting. Now here's what he's going, this is what God did. In the New Testament, we sophisticated that word a little bit, and we called it imputed. Imputed. Same word as counted, but imputed. Yeah. So, what God did for Abraham was that he gave Abraham in the counting, Abraham, when he counted up Abraham's side of the ledger, Abraham was lacking. Except for the fact that Abraham was believing. And when Abraham believed what God told him, then it was counted. I'm going to give you, can we say, I don't know if I just misread that this morning, or was it was an inspirational flash, but it said the word credit. 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 We ain't got good credit, bad credit, whatever kind of credit. Credit means is that we're acting like you can do it. We're acting like you got it. We're acting like you got it. Well, and you know, we're acting like you can pay me back for this money I'm giving you to buy this car. You haven't paid me back yet, but we're going to act like you. You're going to act like the car is yours. You get the title and put it in your name and do all that stuff. Get the insurance, put it in your name, put all kind of wills that you want to do. Do everything. You're acting like it's yours. Am I helping somebody else? Yeah, you're acting like it's. So, accounted or imputed. Now, let's see how the New Testament, New Covenant believers worked with that word counted. We're going to go to what? Candy must have a scripture there. What do you got? Four and three?
Start there.
Okay, we can start there. See, this is now we're getting into our covenant, and this is how we look at it. This is how we see it. Romans 4. All right. Now we're going to see. Okay, what should we say then that Abraham, our father, as pertaining to the flesh, is what we say. We're talking about how man's capability. What was he able to accomplish? That's what it says in verse 2. For if Abraham were justified by works, he had whereof to glory, but not before God. See, Abraham, he probably, if you know, I'm in one language, I'm a jump on him, help him to build a tower. you know, that's a good idea. God had already messed it up, so we know you wouldn't get in that, Abraham, if you could, but I got that all messed up. You can't do that. So don't even think about that. So Abraham, what can you accomplish? What did you do? The scripture said, verse 4, Abraham did what? Believe God. And it was counted unto him for what?
Righteousness.
Righteousness. That's what you want to get. Verse 3. It was counted to him for righteousness. He believed And then God says, here's your credit, it's called righteousness. And now, Abraham, what did he go, look in his own pocket and come up with righteousness? No. God, what, gave it to him. It's like if you're going to go buy a house, buy a car right now, God's going to give, I mean, the people are going to give you what? Credit. How many ever seen credit? Look like. But they give it to you. We're going to act like you can pay us back. It's yours. And so act like it's yours. So here's we're going to count it to you. It's called righteousness. Well, who's righteous? It's God's righteousness. He's just going to give it to you. Now. Hallelujah. Now you can, well, I can call Brother Travis up and mess up his credit score and do some identity theft and stuff and say, Travis ain't got no good credit. But Travis asked us, he's about to step up to the plate and declare for himself, what? I got good credit. I got what it takes to pay it back. And we are righteous because of what Jesus has done. He gave you his righteousness. And God gave Abraham his what? Righteousness. Okay, what do we got here? Continuing on in that scripture. Okay.
Now to him that worketh is reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt.
Mm-hmm.
But to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness.
That's verse 5. His faith, your faith counts for good credit. Your faith counts for righteousness. All right. So even as David also described the blessedness of the man unto whom God does what? That's the word imputed. It's still counted. And I can see it right now, Psalms 32:1. Thank you. You're going to see that right now, Psalms 32:1. If I'm not off my rock. Psalms 32:1. Blessed is he whose transgressions is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord does what? Imputed not iniquity. So God is not counting David's sin against him. And why? Because God says, I'm giving you credit. I'm giving you righteousness. I'm giving you. You ain't got it on your own. You can't come up with it on your own. Because you don't have any righteousness. So God says, I'm going to give you some righteousness. And so that's what happened. So even as Romans 4 and 6, even as David also described the blessedness of the man unto whom God imputed righteousness without works. That's what you want. You want righteousness without having to earn it. And it comes through, it's because what Jesus has done for you. And God says, here's my righteousness. You ain't got no good credit. I started off with bad credit. Anybody else come out to shoot with good credit? I come out with bad credit. Yes. Until so somebody, you go to a lot, they say, well, you need some credit.
Yeah.
How do you get that? Yeah. You got to get in debt. What? You got to get in debt if you want good credit. And so, what we have to do now is that we are in debt. We're in debt to what? Sin. Sin is the debt man owes. But God provided Jesus with righteousness, giving us credit, so that now you can get whatever you want out of here, and it's yours. Oh, good deal. Some folks still want to come up with their own credit. Don't try. It won't work. So he's giving you righteousness. We're almost done the lesson in two. We ain't even halfway through yet. So Genesis 15:12. A little bit later, it says here. And when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abraham. He's already into believing. He's believing at this time. The sun was going down. Deep sleep fell upon April. Was this a natural sleep or something God caused? You believe it's something God caused? Lay down, go to sleep. Deep sleep. What did we find out before in a minute? Deep sleep. Put them in a deep sleep, stuff starts happening. And when you're in a deep sleep, you're not worried. I mean, that's where I like to go. I'm snoring, raising the roof. We got it going. It's all good. Because you can't worry when you're sleeping. So as a deep sleep came on Abraham, God calls it, and lo, and look, and horror of great darkness fell upon him. I'm into believing, and a nightmare is running through my being. I gave you a promise, you're going to have kids more than you can count the dust of the earth, more than you can count the stars. But look what I'm going to show you is going to happen to those kids. And he said unto Abram, know of a surety, I guarantee you, that thy seed should be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and should serve them, and they should afflict them. How many years? Whoa. So, prophetic, yes, this is the prophetic utterance that God has given to Abraham. How many kids does Abraham have now? See, God said, Brother William's going to make you a millionaire, gazillionaire. But your kids, your grandkids are yours. They're so bad. They're so spoiled. They're going to be in a bad situation. You see, some folks will say, Lord, don't give me no money because, you know, it messes up. You'll get messed up over that money. And the drugs and all this and all that. Because, you know, kids not obeying. They ain't going to do what they're supposed to do. Now they're going to be in trouble. I just rather you just not bless us so we don't stay in trouble. Abraham could have said, oh, no, don't let my boy get in there. That's okay. Forget the promise. Let's forget it. It ain't worth all that. 400 years in slavery. Whoa. Man, that's when you get into trying to read God's mind. You're trying to be God. Nope. It's best to just do what? Believe the promise. God says, "For I guarantee you they're going to be slaves for 400 years. Let's go on. Let's go on. And also, that nation whom they serve will I judge. And afterwards shall they come out with what kind of substance? Great substance. Now, see, God knows it's like the end time. We're in a prophetic atmosphere where people start prophesying. There's a little earthquake down there in Central Oklahoma. A couple months back, or everybody got something to say. Prophets come out of the woodwork. stuff is going to get bad. Now, here's what we got to do. We got to understand that God has his time of judgment. And those who need to be judged is in God's timetable. And everything is in God's timetable. That's true. Now, all the way that we can fit into the prophet picture and be right with God is if you just stay and believe. You just stay in faith and be true to God. Okay, so Abraham, he has nothing he can do about this. But God says, when it's time to judge, I will judge, and then your people are going to come out with great substance. Now see, we have to understand, God knows the heart of man. This is some men that God knows they are not going to repent. They're just not going to get saved. They're not going to repent. There's some nations on this earth right now that when Jesus comes, there'll still be an unbelief. There's some places on this earth you can walk, and these people, I don't know how much or what mankind can do, even evangelists, any association of evangelists, they're not going to change these people. one of them is Israel, a nation of Israel. I don't see them the same way. It's not, you're not going to confess the Messiah. I mean, business relationship with a guy who's a Jew. You may be surprised, he told me. I have never read the Bible. What God is to you and what he is to me. As far as Messiah as raising from the dead, born of a virgin, as more, you can go down to the supermarket and buy a Superman comic book. That's the same level they put that story. It does not go on to believe. So God knows who and when, what time to judge folks. So here we go. We've got to speed it up a little bit. Okay. Come out. So your people are going to come out with great substance. Go back to Galatians 3:17. So that's why he judged the nations of Israel. That nation was called Egypt. But when they went down into Egypt, back in Abraham's day, Egypt was a friendly place to go into. And when Abraham received his visitation, it was a friendly place to go into. Remember, he turned south last week to go down there. It's prosperous. Everything's happening down there in Egypt. Let's go in there because the economy's bad where we are. We're going to go into Egypt. And they got into unbelief. Saw a lot of unbelief and non-scriptural stuff going on. But it was a good place to be.
Well, even years later, when Joseph's family, they came into famine in the land, they looked at Egypt.
They went down into Egypt. It's happening down here. Okay, 3:17. Is that right? And this I say, the covenant that was affirmed before of God in Christ, the law which was 430 years after, cannot disannul. That it should make the promise of none effect. In other words, those kids are bad, and they're in slavery, 400 something years. It got so bad now that God says, they won't come to me for nothing, so I'm going to make a law to try and show me you can't live by my law, so therefore you better come to me. But they still would not do it. So what about the promise? Is the promise still in effect?
Yes.
Remember you told Abraham when he was 75? Okay. Well, no. Well, God, maybe you got to change your promise. You surely can't fulfill it in this mess that these guys are in. Okay, let's see. So, how long did Abraham live? Verse 15. And thou shalt go to thy father in peace. Thou shalt be buried in a good old, what's a good old age? How old are you, Abraham? When we finally put you in the hole.
175.
100 years later, after the promise, I finally died. Yeah, God can fulfill his promise. But in the fourth generation, they shall come hither, they shall come back to this land again. For the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet full. In other words, as I'm telling you this right now, the people that's going to put them in slavery, their iniquity is not to the point where I can judge them and be justified in judging them. Wow, what kind of sin did they have? Let's see here. They like boys like boys. That's the kind of stuff that's going on.
They sacrifice the children.
They kill the kids and all like this. They got all kinds of stuff going on that was not in God's will. And as says last week, it made Lot so sick living in that neighborhood. Some neighborhoods that you just not remember. Some people, some friends. It's just, it gets so bad that God has to judge them. Even in the midst of fulfilling his promise. Okay, verse 17 of our lesson. And it should come to pass that when the sun went down, it came to pass, the sun went down, it was dark. Behold, a smoking furnace and a burning lamp that passed between these pieces. Here's what happened there. We said God, when God made a promise and in his vision, he showed Abraham a sacrifice. He built an altar, he put the animals on it, and Abraham saw God walking through the temple making sacrifice. Now, It's singular as to what happened there. Behold, a smoking furnace and a burning fire that passed between these or those pieces. That's what you have to understand, the altar of sacrifice. But what Abraham saw was God walking through his temple. What Abraham didn't see was him and God making that sacrifice. And that's what I'm saying to you, trying to say, when God brings a promise to you, he may show you how it's going to work out. He might not show you how it's going to work out. The one thing you can be assured of, he ain't going to show you in there making it work. He's not going to show you that you, because you did this and you did that, this is what's making it work out. No. And in the temple sacrifice, in the Holy of Holies, which is where that vision is being seen, we can't go, man at that time could not go into the Holy of Holies. Anyway. So with the figure that Abraham saw, he knew that that's God. Because if you went into the Holy of Holies and you wasn't supposed to be in there, what happened? You died. So Abraham was getting this vision.